to invoke Oseledec, much simpler. Is enough to invoke ergodicity. So actually, the work of Oseledec is a sort of ergodic theorem for some sophisticated stuff, but in the logic. Okay, we start from this. We start from xt plus 1 equal f of xt. Okay, now imagine that I start from x0 and I generate xt. And then I start from x0 plus from x0 prime equal x0 plus delta 0, and I generate x prime t, which will be equal to xt plus something by definition. And you want to understand this stuff. Okay? But it's very simple. So you consider this equation. You will see x prime t plus 1 is equal f x prime t. Okay? So this is x t plus 1 plus delta t plus 1 equal to what? F of x t plus delta t. Now, if you work if you assume that this is small, if you assume f of xt plus f prime xt delta t plus order delta t squared. Okay. So, if you assume that this is small, if you that this is small, you adjust, you simplify this with this, and you have delta t plus 1 is equal f prime xt delta t. Okay. Strictly speaking, you have also this term. So you have this equation. So this equation is tautologically true, but you have this part that is disturbing. And so the idea is to define the Lyapunov exponent in a proper way, in this way. Let me call lambda. In this case, there is only one lambda, but the official name is the maximum characteristic exponent, but just for friend, Lyapunov exponent. So this is defined as the limit t go to infinite of the log of delta t over delta 0, 1 over t, but before this limit, I take the limit delta 0 go to 0. Okay? So I assume that delta 0 is small before I take delta 0 small, and then the limit t go to infinite. So in the picture, so you remember the picture before, no? We have something like that, no? So I take delta 0 very small. I take delta 0 very small in such a way the interval time for which you have the exponential is very large. Okay? I have this stuff. So this is the trick to take before this limit and then this. Okay? So the mathematician who like to invent pompous name consider another equation where this is removed. So they call the term tangent vector.
Sorry, Angelo, this depends on xt, on Sorry? Where you start.
Yeah, yeah, exact. This can depend on x0. This depend x. Then I show you that, okay, this can, in principle, this can depend on x0. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, thanks. Yeah. I forget to mention this. So the tangent vector, okay, in this case, it's not a vector, but the tangent vector z of t, and tangent vector and z of t evolve in this way. So practically, it's the previous equation where I just delete the term order delta.
So it's the first derivative there, right?
Yeah. Thanks. Fortunately, I have the chairman, which is very precise. And this is so this means that z of t is delta t. It's delta t, but delta t small. Small at any time, but how is possible to have small at any time? You have to take extremely small at delta zero and so on. So in this way, this automatically is true, okay? So if you introduce this trick, it's not necessary to perform this because automatically you will perform this limit. Okay, this is the trick. The trick is using this way, automatically you have this limit. And so, and you have the Lyapunov exponent, which of course depends on x0, is the limit. In the limit t go to infinite, 1 over t log z t over z0. Okay, you already start. Okay, now this depends only from x0. The first question, this quantity has a strong relation with the ergodicity. This is not obvious, you don't see. You don't see, but if you look carefully, if you look enough, I show you in 20 seconds that this quantity is nothing but a time average. Doesn't appear a time average, but I can write this as a time average. Why? Because just this. Here, log of z, let me write in this way, z of t, z t minus 1, z t minus 1, z t minus 2, z 1, z 0. It's the same, you see? It's the same because you simplify this with this, okay. So, with modulus. So you see that you can write this way. But now, okay, you remind the definition of this. This is limit t go to infinite, 1 over t, sum j from 0 to t minus 1, log of f prime xt, xj, modulus. Now you see, this is time average. This is a time average. And so now, reminded the first Birkhoff-Neumann theorem. This for sure exists. And in principle is a function of lambda zero, or x0, in principle, okay? Now you can wonder, is really a function of x0 or not? Okay, depends. So if the system is ergodic, it's not a function of x0. Okay. The proof that it's ergodic, another story, you know, okay? So you have that. Now, if the system is ergodic, then you have that lambda is equal to, so lambda, you see that lambda is the is this quantity. Huh? If it's ergodic, this is the integral of rho invariant x log f prime x. If this is invariant, you have a precise definition. Okay, and you can compute. So you can compute in terms of the invariant distribution, and that's it. So, for example, in the case of the trivial exercise, in the case of the 10 map. In the case of the 10 map, so you have the f prime is 2, and modulus, so, and this is constant. This is immediately that this is just a log of 2. Okay, in this case, you are just a log of 2. Okay? And you can wonder what is the Lyapunov exponent of the logistic map is still log 2. Why? So you can perform a brute force just using this formula and performing some integral if you are clever enough with some trick, or you can wonder a more general question. What happens if I have a system and I perform a topological conjugation? The Lyapunov exponent remain the same or not? The answer will be yes, remain the same. It's possible to prove, it's not difficult, it's just I have no time, but you can find on our book or everywhere you find. Okay? So you have that the Lyapunov exponent is invariant under topological conjugation. This is very important because it means that it's not important if you use a variable x or x cube. It's the same. So this is an intrinsic property. It doesn't change if you change the language. Okay? So the Lyapunov exponent is an intrinsic property. It's an intrinsic property. It's not a property which depends on the variable you're using. Otherwise, it's somehow a stupid property. If something changes with x or s cubed, it's stupid. Okay? So this is the result. Without proof, but so.
Angelo, we have a question on the chat. On Poincaré Bendison, he says it's valid only for integer dimensions. The question is, can we have a tractor in a dimension between 1 and 2?
Question. So it's necessary to distinguish the situation with the continuous time or discrete time. With continuous time, so differential equation, you need at least 3 dimensions. This is as a consequence of Poincaré Bendison theorem. On the contrary, in one dimension, in discrete time, one variable is enough. So this is what we prove. This is the proof. No, this is the proof because it's the tenth map.
Yes. Then from the intuitive proof we gave, I understand 2D should be taken something like a lower bound to a lower critical dimension for chaos.
Okay, it's what I said before. The question is, can I have an attractor? Yeah, in dimension between 1 and 2, yes, we discuss tomorrow. Tomorrow, in the NO map, the dimension is between 1 and 2. Depends on the value, with the usual parameter you find on the book, the fractal dimension is something like 1.25. I know very well because when I was younger, I compute many, many times this stuff. Inventing some method and so on. Yeah, a map is an archetype of a two-dimensional chaotic system, dissipative. And the dimension is between 1 and 2. Okay, so the lambda is invariant under topological conjugation. Okay, this is in 1D, the proof is just a direct checking, but it's valid in any dimension. So the Lyapunov exponent are something. Okay, I define all this. Okay, this is the Lyapunov exponent in 1D. So the Lyapunov exponent in 1D, there is no particular difficulty. Okay, it's just this stuff. Now you wonder what happens if I consider let me discuss it for maps. For the differential equation, the situation is very similar. But if you consider a two-dimensional map, for example, a NO map, immediately you realize a terrible problem. Why? The problem is the following. Let me write the NO map. Com'era? Era. Okay, this is DynoMap. And the idea is just to repeat the approach before and to write the tangent vector. So the tangent vector means delta x, okay? So if I add the tangent vector, let me call zeta 1, zeta 1 is associated to x, zeta 1 t plus 1 is equal to minus a, minus 2 a x t zeta 1 t plus zeta 2 t zeta, I guess, if I write in compact way, z vector t plus 1 is equal to a matrix which is minus 2a x t 1 b 0 zeta t. Okay, I have this equation. Okay, so for the tangent vector means zeta, means delta x. Repeating the argument before. So I have that the evolution of the tangent vector is given applying a certain matrix to the vector at the previous time. Note, this is the matrix. So the structure of the problem is the following. The structure of the problem in 1D, we have this structure. In D more 2, we have z plus 1 is equal to a certain matrix which depends on xt. You have this. This is the structure. Okay? So, and now you want to understand how behave z in time. Okay? And so the problem is the following. So imagine that you start with a certain x0 and you start with a certain z0. Okay? You compute all this stuff and then you look at the limit t go to infinite 1 over t log of modulus. Okay, so the time is just in this. Modulus of this over modulus of this. Okay? You look at this quantity. So, of course, this quantity must depend from x0 and z0. Okay? So, these are called Lyapunov exponents. So, of course, in the problem is that this quantity, which depends of these two stuff, okay? And so you see that the difference with the one-dimensional case is related to the fact that, in general, A, this matrix, does not commute. So if the matrix commutes, the problem is trivial. The problem is trivial. The entire situation is when the matrix does not commute, because if it's commuted, you are back to the previous case. Just diagonalize for this component, no? Because in this case, what you have in this way, you have zt is equal to the product of f prime xj, j from 0 to t minus 1, z0. You have this. If you repeat here, you have the same, but the problem is that now the product must be computed in the correct chronological order. Well, here is not important. So you have this product, this must be a x t minus 1, a x t minus 2, up to a x 1, z0. Okay? So you have this product of matrices in a proper order. Okay? If it's possible, if this commute, the problem is trivial. Okay, but the fact that in this case, you see, this doesn't commute. This doesn't compute because it depends on the evolution of xt. So the computation of this stuff is absolutely non-trivial. And the first point is that just is necessary to prove that there exists this stuff. Oh, the existence of this stuff is not trivial, because before it was just a consequence of ergodicity. Now no, because no, now also in this case a consequence of ergodicity, but the proof is necessary to invoke an important a non-trivial theorem. Okay, the non-trivial theorem is the theorem of Selleck. Okay, the theorem of Selleck is following. The theorem of Selleck is that when you perform this quantity, now look at the dependence of x z0. So in principle, you can expect that you can have all the possible value depending of z0. But actually, the possible results are only two. In this case, we are in two dimensions. In more than in d dimension, we have d value. So the theorem, a way to mention the Oseledek theorem without entering in the detail. Without entering the detail, the Oseledek theorem in this case, say that the limit t go to infinity 1 over t log of zt modulus z0 is equal to lambda 1, we can depend on lambda 0, or lambda 2, which depends on lambda 0. There are only two possibilities, depending on z0. So, if, depending on the z0. And so, what happens is the following, that for almost all z0, you have this one. In order to have, and this is, let me call it, smaller than lambda 1.
Lambda 1 and lambda 2
are called the Lyapunov exponent. The Lyapunov characteristic exponent. This is the first Lyapunov exponent, this is the second characteristic exponent. And so, in the other case. So, in more than one dimension, you have the first, the second, the third, and so on. So, you have the number of Lyapunov exponents, how many degrees of freedom you have. Okay. And this depends on z0. So, in order to understand the trouble, this is not a proof, this is just to have an intuition. Let us consider the case where A is constant, doesn't depend on time. So if it doesn't depend on time, you have that z of t is equal to A to t z0. Okay? And then if you consider the eigenvalue problem, okay, this is equal to alpha k. Okay, so imagine that you find the alpha 1, alpha 2, okay, and so you write z0 as a certain c1 v1 plus c2 v2. So the evolution of z of t is c1 alpha 1 to t v1 plus c2 alpha 2 t v2. Okay, now let me assume that alpha 1 modulus is larger than alpha 2. Okay, so in this case, what happened? If C1 is different from zero, yeah, so the z0 has a non-zero projection on the most expanding direction, the leading term is this one. So in this case, you have the zt behave like alpha 1 to t. Okay? So on the contrary, if C1 is equal to zero, you have alpha 2. So you see that this is selected almost sure, apart the very strange situation. Okay? But if you want, it's possible. Okay, this is the essence of the theorem. So no, this is not a theorem. This is just why you have this dependence of z0. Okay, this is just the definition. This is just the theorem. And then you can wonder, okay, but how I can compute this stuff? How I can compute? Is it possible to compute in some efficient way this stuff? This is another story. Now the fact that there exists this limit is a sort of ergodic property and is strictly associated to the statistical statistical mechanics of disorder system. Maybe let me spend the rest of this class to show you why this problem of the product of Lyapunov's product of random matrices are common both to chaotic system to disorder system. Okay. You told me that you are familiar with the transfer matrix stuff. So let me just write the just for the notation and let me, so I okay, let's consider a one-dimensional spin glass, okay? It's a tribute to Giorgio Parisi, my professor. So you have a 1D random easy model. So something like that. Right? So the so you have some random coupling and random magnetic field. And you have to write the partition function. So the partition function will depend on the temperature, will depend on all this coupling and all this stuff. Okay? So and you write this sigma 1, sigma n, exponentially of these things. So here you have the sum on n, here we have beta jn sigma n plus 1 plus beta hn sigma n, we have this. And then you can just take the on the circle, so sigma n plus 1 is sigma 1, something like that. Okay? So now you note that you can write this. You can write this quantity using the trick of the transfer matrix. So if you introduce this, let me introduce this sigma prime matrix, like equal to, let me put here n here, beta jn sigma prime plus beta h n sigma. Okay, if I introduce this, I have that zeta n is the sum of sigma 1 sigma of t sigma 1 sigma 2 t sigma 2 sigma 3 and so on t sigma n minus 1 sigma n. Okay. No, let me tell you this one, sigma n. Okay. So you see that, you see? And this is so you see that you can write this as the trace of this product. The product, no. This is 1, this is 2, this is n. You have the product of this stuff. You have the product and stuff. So now you okay? If these are constant, if these are constant, is enough to compute the first and second. No? In the case they are constant, this is just lambda 1 n plus lambda 2 n, where lambda 1 and lambda 2 are the eigenvalue of t. Okay, and this is simple. And so you see that what is really important is only lambda 1, and the maximum 1, because when you take the free energy, you take the free energy per particle, mean kt log of z n over n, you have this is just minus kt log lambda 1 plus smaller term. Okay? So you see that the free energy is given by the maximum eigenvalue of the matrix. Okay, this is for the trivial case. Now repeat the game for the random case. So if you repeat the game for random case and you don't know, you are very naive, you are not familiar with this problem of the system, what you have, that you have f n equal to minus k log zeta n over n. Okay, this is the main kt, the log of the trace of this product divided by n. Of course, this quantity, if you don't know nothing, is a function of what? Is a function of n, is a function of t, and is a function of all j and all h. Right? Yeah, this one. So if you are completely naive, you have this stuff. But what is important? So this is then you can wonder, but if I take this quantity and I perform an average, then average on what? The average on this quantity here. Okay. We have this stuff. And then the probability of all the j, the probability of, and this there. I write in a formal way, huh? It's clear what means it. Right. This is all the. I have a number, okay? I have a number, but of course this is horrible. So this is horrible, and from a conceptual point of view, means that you have an experiment, you have a disordered system with a gold, with some purity of iron, and then you move the impurity and compute the free energy and then perform the average on all the possible ways you have to compute the impurity. It's ridiculous. Nobody is able to do this. Then you can wonder, if I perform a unique experiment means with a unique realization of the disorder, with n large enough, what I have? No, if I take this, and I look at the limit n go to infinite, I obtain this or not? Okay, this is from a physical point of view, it's a very precise question, because this means that I have just one situation, and this is representative of the ensemble. This is enough. Okay? So you see that the answer from a physical point of view is yes. I hope this. And from a mathematical point of view, why I can say yes? I can say yes because of the Euler theorem. Because this at the end of the story, this apart the decoration, apart the decoration, this is the logarithm, this is the Lyapunov exponent, or the logarithm of Lyapunov exponent. Because when perform this product, apart very rare situation, I obtain always the average. It's like in the large number theory, the theory of large number. So you perform the sum of, in principle you can obtain everything, but you obtain always the good value, which is the mean value. This is exactly the same. But of course, it's highly non-trivial. This is a consequence of this Euler theorem. The official name is multiplicative ergodic theorem. because it's associated with some multiplication. The non-trivial part is associated with the fact that the matrix doesn't commute. Okay. This is the, so this is the connection with the two field. Okay, this is a connection with the two field. Then next step is how you can compute. This is another story, how you can compute this number. You can try to compute with some analytical effort. I spent some years when I was young on this. I also write a book. I can send to you the book. And or there are some analytical method, approximation, which whose difficulty does not depend on the dimension of the system. Even 2D, the problem is difficult. It's not the fact that if 2D is simple in 20, no. No, in 2D is simple, it's difficult. It's difficult, that's it. So there are not a systematic approach. There are some methods developed by many people. Derrida work a lot on this stuff. And, okay, but I don't want to discuss about the analytical method. I just want to discuss about how to compute numerically. How to compute numerically, and then what is the connection with the other problem? Because apparently I split the problem in the time and space, but actually there is a connection. These are not two split problems, two aspects of the same stuff, and there is a bridge between these two. So before to let me spend the last 10 years just discussing the method due to Benettini and the other people. which is a computational translation of the Osele-Dec theorem. Okay, I discussed this in the case of the Enum map, and then you can generalize it. When you will have time, maybe you can play with this, and just you can write the code is trivial. It's just a few lines. So start with let me write the. This we are in 2D, okay? We are in 2D. Then I write the Z equation. The Z is equal to a certain matrix, which depends on X, Z, or T. How is this matrix? This matrix is just IJ, it's just the derivative of Fi, Xj, compute along the trajectory. That's it, okay? But in the case of Enum map, it was this A is minus A, X, no, there is a factor 2. Maybe there is a factor 2 here, I don't remember. Yeah, there is a factor 2. Apparently, it's an innocent structure, but it's not intelligent at all. Okay, apparently, it's very. So, this problem of random matrix, when you read it for the first time, you say, oh, come on, I had to manage 2D matrix, who cares? It's not so. And okay, you have this. Then the computation of the first one, okay. First characteristic variable exponent, lambda 1. So lambda 1 is defined in the same way. So you start with a certain x0. So let's assume that system is ergodic, otherwise remain independence of x0. And you start with z0. And then you iterate both. You see? In order to compute the Lyapunov exponent, you have to iterate the system because you need this matrix. You iterate the system, and then you compute z of t. And then you take the limit t go to infinite 1 over t log of z t over z0. Okay? So if you do this, with probability 1, you obtain lambda 1. This approach, this for t go to infinity, this approach to lambda 1, with probability 1, in the sense that unless you are so unlucky that you consider z0 perpendicular to the most expanding, you obtain lambda 1. But don't worry, if you are unlucky, the computer will solve your trouble. Because
If I think of doing this, I will have a zt which is exponentially larger than z0, and then maybe I will get a round of errors.
Right. So this is the technical, not technical, this is the practical trick. Okay, this is just, now, how to solve the practical trick, this problem. This is very simple. And this trick is a clean trick. It's not a dirty trick. So there are two kinds of trick. The trick where you are cheating, but this trick, you are not cheating, okay? You observe the following, so you see, of course, this increase a lot. You expect to have trouble with the numerics, but you look at this argument that you can write this as you can fix a certain time tau, which is not important, depends only on your computer, maybe 3, 5, 10, even 1 if you like. And so you can write in this way, you can write this as zt minus tau, zt minus tau, zt minus 2 tau, and so on, okay? So let me call this, so here you have that this is the sum of log of z. Let me call this tn minus 1, where tn is equal n tau. And here I write this this way. Okay. So, and then I take the limit capital N go to infinity. Then, why this is nice? It's nice the fact that, note that this quantity, if I change this, this change, but the ratio doesn't change. Why? Because the dynamics of the tangent vector is linear. So this means that I can use the following trick, the following clean trick. I start with z at 0, for example, modulus equal 1. Why not? Then I compute zeta at time t1. Okay? And then I have alpha 1, which is the stuff. Then I rescale, zeta prime at t1 is equal to z at t1 divided by alpha 1. In such a way, zeta prime has modulus 1. And then repeat, and I have alpha 2, and so on. And this is a clean trick, because I just use the fact that the evolution of this stuff is linear. And so at the end of the story, I have limit n go to infinity, 1 n tau, sum of log of alpha j, alpha n. Okay, and this is a way to avoid numerical overflow. Because you can take also this, even 1 if you like. Okay, then you have to decide if to rescale too often you spend your time, but so in this way you avoid the trouble of the overflow. Now you can how you can compute the second one. The second one is more complicated, maybe tomorrow. Okay, but let's start with the idea, then tomorrow I scan. The second, the computation of the second, so the idea is to start with zeta 1, 0, and another zeta 2, 0, this perpendicular. So you start with these two. So this is zeta 1. So you know that asymptotically this will increase in some direction. Okay. Then if you start at random, even this will collapse very close to this. Of course, it's impossible to avoid. Okay. But if you start now, you instead to look at the distance, you look at the area between these two stuff, you realize that this area, the growth of this area, the growth of the area increase as the sum of the Lyapunov exponent. So this area at time t is the area at time zero exponentially, lambda 1 plus lambda 2 at time t. Of course, this here you have horrible, horrible problem with the underflow, because now this increase became infinite, but this angle go to zero, so you have to. So the trick is to perform Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization. So you repeat the game, not only to rescale this, but also to orthonormalize after a certain time. Okay, you start from this, you arrive to a situation like this, and you perform an orthonormalization. This remains this, and this, and so on. Okay, and you compute the area and blah blah blah. Okay, but so the problem is that if you want to compute the second Lyapunov exponent, you cannot compute the second Lyapunov exponent if you don't know the first. So I am interested in a system with the 200,000 Lyapunov exponent. I want to compute the Lyapunov exponent 1023. Okay, you can do, but you have to compute all the previous one. Okay, this is the method, which is not impossible. Which is so. For example, when I was younger, we computed with some thousand. So with also with Stefano Ruffo, it was in our game when we were young. To compute many Lyapunov exponent, but it's not particularly difficult. It's just long. You need just to. Okay, tomorrow I'll continue to discuss this stuff. But in addition, the Lyapunov exponent has some property, and I missed to discuss the property of the Lyapunov exponent. Tomorrow I'll continue.
Okay, thank you very much. So we continue tomorrow. Today, some of you will go to CISA, and there were some questions on how to go to CISA. I think you will receive shortly some instruction on where the bus will be, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? Thank you very much.